Hey everyone, welcome, thanks for coming. My name is Remi, and today I'm gonna do the talk about RenderDoc and mobile optimization. This place is loud, so I'm gonna try to speak loudly. Sorry if you can't hear. Also, the screens are smaller than I expected, so I hope you have good eyes. So, sorry about that. First thing, this is a completely live talk. I have no backup, no slides, no nothing. This is a live tool, so bear with me as we will have problems, and we will see if, like good rock and roll, live tools about GPU optimizations are better live. So, today we are going to talk about a tool called RenderDoc. What RenderDoc is, it's a frame capture system. So it allows you to run your app and at some point click a button, and the tool will record every draw call, every command that your app is sending to the GPU, and will show you exactly what your app actually does, which most of the time is very different from what you expect it to do. And then it will, using this will help you debug issues and optimize performance, which is what the rest of the talk will be about, which is me, I have traced before this talk plenty of apps that we have in the store and all that, and just like seeing how they could do stuff a bit better to get that extra 20 or 30% that you could have if you had like the perfect app that doesn't exist. So RenderDoc, as of version 1.1, which is the latest release version, officially works with Go and Oculus Quest, which I will try to remember that it's now is Oculus Quest. The only issue is that there is an optimization that Unreal 4.20 did that broke RenderDoc's multi-view implementation. So if you want to use 4.20, you need to use the nightly builds. I don't have internet, that's fine. After September 9th. So today, that's what actually we're going to use. So I pre-downloaded it. So we have this RenderDoc 9.9 here that we will do the presentation for. So when you double click on RenderDoc, this happens, which is the main RenderDoc interface that we have access to. And today we're going to show how to use this on mobile platforms. So RenderDoc by default works very well on PC, and plenty of devs, or majority of Rift devs use it. But today specifically, we're going to talk about optimizations on Go and on Oculus Quest. So the first thing I want to show is, and bring attention to, is this little replay context local on the bottom left here. When you click on this, you get to see local, which means that you would be doing PC debugging, or Oculus standalone HMD offline. So how this worked is this uses ADB. It scans all the devices that you have on your computer. Right now, I have my Oculus Quest right here, plugged in through USB. And so it knows that I have an Oculus Quest that is, that could be running RenderDoc, but the RenderDoc system is not currently running on the device. So I get to click on this. It says running remote server command. I have to wait a couple seconds, and now my screen is completely green, which is the RenderDoc icon on my display. And I have remote server ready here. If I go to launch application, which is how you launch an application on PC, what it does is that it redirects the application searching from executables on your PC to listing APKs that are installed on this device to be able to trace them. So when I click here, I get to see all the applications that actually have been installed. And today, we're going to be debugging Ocean Rift. So just a little interlude so that I explain how this works under the hood. There are two ways. So the cool thing with this is that you do not need to package your app specifically for RenderDoc in order to be able to analyze it. Previously, other debuggers, such as Mali Graphics Debugger in previous versions or others, you needed to have a special type of packaging in order for the app to be debuggable. You needed to package the app with a library from the tool. Here, this uses native Android hooking in order to do that. What that means is that when your app is going to launch, your app wants to link to, let's say, libgl, right? And so your app is going to say, hey, I want libgl to give me actual implementations of functions such as gl draw elements, or gl clear, or gl bind buffer. The app isn't aware of this because all those functions are implemented outside of the app because we use dynamic linking, otherwise every app would be worth 10 gigabytes. And so the app just requests from the OS, hey, OS, give me gl draw elements. When RenderDoc launches an app, it redirects that link so that when the app calls gl draw buffers, what actually happens in the background is that gl draw buffer calls a RenderDoc function that logs, hey, your application just called gl draw buffers, and then RenderDoc's implementation of gl draw buffers then calls the real gl draw buffers so that the app actually runs on my headset. Linux and Android lets you do that in two cases. One, your device is rooted and unlocked. If that's the case, then you can do that on every app ever, which is the case of this headset. But it's not the case of your headsets. In your headsets, you just need the app to be compiled for development. Then Android just lets you do whatever you want, including hooking. So right now, I'm going to double-click on Ocean Rift Full. It's scanning for RenderDoc support, which it does not need because I have a rooted headset. And then I get to click Launch. So right now, this goes to black. I get to see the waiting for debugger application Ocean Rift ready to launch. Screen back to black. And now I'm in Ocean Rift. Perfect. I get to like walk around and play my game exactly like I would do in a real context. So the way you know that's happening right now is because on target here, I've got Ocean Rift and my PID number, which is my process ID. If I were to use ADB, I would be able to grab that PID to get information about my app. And here, connection status established and API OpenGLES. OpenGLES here, and this is important, is in bold. That means that the app is currently submitting frames. It's not asleep. It didn't have an OpenGL context at some point and then crashed. That would be if it showed OpenGLES not presenting. This means currently rendering. So I get to click on capture frames. Here, my headset just froze for 1 second, and now I'm back in the game. For that 1 second, basically every single buffer that was sent to the device got completely stored and transferred over to my computer to this trace. As you can see, I have still not implemented, although that's on my list of stuff to do, the thumbnail functionality. So now it's black because it's reading from the back buffer, but obviously we don't have a back buffer in VR because we render into a subchain, therefore it's black. Anyway, that's in my list of like when I get bored. So you get to double click on it, and then on the left side, we're now in frame capture mode. My app is still running, and basically RenderDoc is using the spare GPU cycles in order to replay everything I need on my computer. The main thing that we see here are GL draw elements and GL clears. Those are commands that are actively modifying the state of the frame buffer. They're actually doing stuff. Obviously, there are many more commands actually being sent, but we will be able to inspect them. They are not as important. If I get to click on a GL draw elements feature here, I can go in texture viewer and look at what I actually rendered. The fact that this works, by the way, like on a mobile device, transmitting all of this, rendering here, and showing me all those pixels on the PC is kind of mind-blowing. The first time it actually worked for me, I was like, honestly, I was actually mind-blown because we never got that level of frame debugging on PC. What people usually do is that they run their game in preview mode on PC and then profile it on the PC, hoping that it's the same thing actually happens on the mobile device. But the fact that this is actually rendering on my device and transmitting all those buffers through that wire and that this works in real time, I actually didn't think it would work at all. And then, yeah, well, anyway, it's really cool. So you get to the cool thing and like the really amazing thing about this debugger is that you can do what we call partial frame playback. So you get to click on a draw call and look at what the frame would look like only if you had the draw calls until that draw call. So for example, here, obviously, I clicked on the last one, so it looks like what I saw on the headset. But if I were just to click in the middle, all the draw calls after this draw call I clicked through wouldn't have gone through. So I can step through my entire frame and look at every single draw call's additive effects on my texture. So if you start at the clear, obviously when you only have a clear, then you only have the clear color. And then you step through and you get the water. And then you get the fishes at the back. And then you get more fishes. And then you get more bubbles. And then you start adding like click back button for menu. And then you add the Ocean Rift logo. And you can do this for any app. And so you can really figure out if the draw calls that you're actually sending through are useful or if they are not. And a lot of them are not going to be, and this is when you get to do optimization, which is what the rest of this talk is going to be about. So the first thing I wanted to show with Ocean Rift is that it is the only app I think I've ever seen in my life developing and looking at video games where most, this was like just fun that I figured that out, where most of the pixels that you're actually going to see have not been modified. Since it's a C app and you're basically just looking into the C, they figured out that nobody would actually notice if they just cleared the back buffer to the color of the C and never then touch those pixels. Then, most of the time you have like a cube map in the background, right? And then you look at your cube map and that's how you do your effects that are far. Or people do like, so some people do ray marching because they want to spend a bunch of time doing that. Some people just have objects. They literally just cleared and left most of the pixels just cleared, which I thought was beautiful. Because like when you're developing on a device such as this one, you kind of need to be smart in order to gain the performance, because the device doesn't have endless amounts of performance. It's not like you have a 2080 Ti and you can just throw everything you want at it and then put ray tracing on top. Like, you need to be smart here to develop a really good app on this. And one of the ways you do this is figuring out what you don't actually need to do. And here they figured out that they did not need to render the background of the water because water is blue, and if they just clear to blue, then most people are actually gonna focus on the other objects and never notice. So this is actually what they do. The second thing is the water. So let's actually take that water draw call in order for us to figure out what the what some of the really cool features of RenderDoc are. So if you go on the right side here, in outputs, I have two outputs. I have FB0, which is color 0. That means it's the color texture I'm rendering into. And then just below that, I have what we call DS, which is depth stencil, and that's my depth buffer. Although in this app it works, honestly, depth stencil is not the most stable feature because getting depth out of a mobile chipset is really hard. So here you can click on it. It's completely white because it's mostly far content. If you modify the range, you get to see depth slowly appearing because most of it is actually between 0.9 and 1 in terms of value we store. And then all the way to the back, you would get to see the fishes, but it's not as important. On the input side, you get to see the textures that you have used and that were binded into the OpenGL state when that draw call was emitted. On the left side here, in the API inspector, you get to see all the little GL calls that were necessary in order for that draw call to work. So you have the GL use program, which where you bind your shader. You have all the other GL use programs. You have GL buffer subdata, where you get buffers sent over to the GPU. You bind your vertex attributes so that you have all your mesh rights. And then you do the actual GL draw elements. Here we can see that we have three textures. We have WaterText1, WaterText2, that have slightly different zoom levels, and then we have the reflection texture. The reflection texture is used to create, well, obviously the reflections that you can see all the way at the top here that I'm currently zooming into. And so this is pretty cool, but you might ask me, well, I'm in my game, and like right now I'm currently seeing the water is actually moving in a way that's fairly realistic. So I know it's not only texturing that it's doing, because the water actually is moving up and down like a real water would in real life. And so you might ask me, how did it do that? So this is where we get to use what we call mesh output. So mesh output is one of the best, in my opinion, features of RenderDoc, where you get to see the mesh that you submitted to the GPU, but even more interestingly, the mesh post-vertex shader and post-projection that went out. This is something that you usually never get to see, because you can look in your game engine at what you're submitting to the engine by just looking at your mesh, right? But you never get to see what the GPU does to it. But here you do. So let's look at their shader here. I know my screen is really small, so I'm going to zoom in here. So here we see that what they're rendering is a very highly tessellated flat mesh. As you see, I'm just looking around here, and this mesh is perfectly flat. But I know that's not how it gets rendered, because when I was looking at my game, it didn't look flat. And I know it wasn't normal mapping or like bump mapping on all of those really cool techniques, because when I actually dive up, which is something you can do in this game, you can literally physically see the triangles going up and down. So I know it's not only a hack. And hacks are amazing, don't get me wrong. Normal mapping, if you can get away with normal mapping, please go do normal mapping. But it just doesn't work when you actually can swim in the water and see the triangles go up and down, right? So if you click on VS Out, you get to see the vertex shader, what the vertex shader outputs. So here you can see that there are lines, white lines on the top, on the bottom, on the left, and on the right. This is what we call NDC space. This is my -1, -1, -1, -1. This is the representation of my texture post-projection. So all of the vertices that are in between those lines are useful because they are actually ending up in my texture. This is how they are ending up. Post-projection, this is where the GPU puts the triangles on my texture. Everything that's outside gets projected outside of the texture, outside of NDC space, and OpenGL will cull all those triangles instead of rendering them, because you're not going to actually end up in the texture. This is how you can see that, because in Texture Viewer, you can see that the mesh, the water mesh, is approximately in the same region in this texture that it is in mesh output in those lines, which makes sense because that's how the GPU works. You can, kind of like if you were playing Counter-Strike, walk around this mesh using WAD, and you can see that here they're actually doing some things on the vertices, because that's not a flat mesh anymore. You can literally see here there's actual vertex modifications in order to simulate real water. If you go to pipeline state here, you get to see where the texture maps are actually being used. So here, if I go to fragment shader all the way there, I can see my three textures that were that I saw in input. So how a lot of people are going to do water simulation, that's how like Sea of Thieves does it, for example, is that you have a texture, and in the vertex shader, you use that texture to sample the texture at the position of all your vertices, and that texture is going to be a floating point normalized, and that it is going to tell you if you want to be like the height of your vertex. But here in vertex shader, I don't see any textures being used. So they must be doing something in that vertex shader to figure out where they want those vertices to be without reading it from a texture. So let's look at what they do. One of the cool things about RenderDoc is that you get in vertex shader to click on view here, and it will show you your shader. It is very likely you have never seen that shader before. If you use Unity or UE4, the shaders are, most of them are generated procedurally for you. In UE4, if you create a material, for example, you have that little like fancy blueprint stuff where you get to like connect visually things, and then you just ask UE4 to please handle the OpenGL mess for you, and then it creates a shader. So you've likely never seen that shader. But it's actually really cool to be able to see the shader, because sometimes the procedural stuff doesn't work as well as you intended, and you don't really know what's going to execute on the GPU. But that's what you care about. If you want to do optimization, looking at the shader is cool. And so here, you can see that what they actually did, we'll just focus on the first two lines, but basically what they do is that they multiply the position of their vertex, which is that flat, highly tessellated mesh, by a vertex wave frequency and time. So they just used basic math, which is like the sinus wave systems, right, to have a multi-pronged wave system, and they just multiply that on the vertex shader to create their water. And I really want to emphasize this here. One of the things that are that is going to make your app slow, and this is what I'm going to continue talking about here, is bandwidth transfer, where you have data on one side in like main memory, for example, and you want your GPU cache to have it because you want your GPU to sample from it. That data needs to go from A to B, and it has like 5 watts to do it, so it's going to be slow. So everything you can do to limit the amount of memory transfer between places is going to be huge. And here, instead of either generating that mesh on the CPU and sending it every frame, or putting stuff in a texture and sending it every frame, they got away with having a fully realistic water simulation system with exactly 4 floats. They have wave speed, vertex wave amplitude, vertex wave frequency, and time. 4 floats, it's like 32 bytes, depending on the precision, I guess. And they got like an actual really nice looking water system where you can actually dive through. So be smart. That's pretty much all. So we can continue here. I hope that you can see this, but basically here, as I step through, we can see in the background that there are fishes and bubbles that appear. I'm not going to spend thousands of hours on this. What I did like is that, again, they thought about the precision that they needed to actively do what they wanted to do in their game, and they didn't go further. If you look at this fish texture here, all the way top, MIP 0, 256 by 256. That is the maximum size of their fish texture. They figured out that this is not a fish simulation system. The fishes are going to be far from you. You're never going to intersect them with your head. They know where your head is because this is an Oculus Go game. They don't need 1024 by 1024. They don't need a 4K texture. They can get away with 256. That's less data to transfer. They went with 256. I can't emphasize how important that is, and I am actually really glad that they did this. Same thing for the other redfishes, 256, 256 again. They figured out you don't need more. If you don't need more, why would you use that? Cool. And then let's quickly continue. nothing insane in this app. Obviously, it's a fairly simple menu. I didn't want to go further because I have other apps for that I really want to show you guys, but this is basically what it is. Last thing, if I really wanted to be nitpicky, which sometimes is fun, but isn't the goal here, I just wanted to call out, like, basically, and this is going to be something I really emphasize again, is texture samples are expensive. They're not expensive because sampling from a matrix is expensive. If you know exactly the UVs that you want, like a computer is able to go look in a matrix very easily. It's not like you need to do double derivatives to go look at it. The reason why textures are expensive is because they store a lot of data. The bigger your texture is, the more data that you need to transfer between your main memory and your cache. If you sample from different areas of that texture, if you're only sampling from the same 2 pixels, the fact that your texture is 4K, 4K isn't really gonna matter because the cache is never gonna be thrashed because you're always looking at pixels that are in the cache. But if you have a 4K by 4K texture and you're reading from the left and the right and the bottom and the top, then every time you do a new sample, you're gonna need to flush your cache. And this cache flush is why things get slow. And so here, for example, if you really wanted to be nitpicky, which you don't really need to, but if you double click on Ocean Rift, you can see that it's a 1024 by 1024 texture. But here in outputs, you can see that I'm outputting in a texture that's around 1024 by 1024, and this Ocean Rift logo is taking maybe like 20% of that complete texture. You know it's never gonna be bigger because this is a headset. This was made for a 3DoF headset where your head stays at the exact same place. So that logo is never gonna come in your face. You do not have a way to go look at it closer. You do not have a way to make it bigger. So really, realistically, you're only gonna actually use 300 of those pixels, potentially even less. So why store and transfer 1024 by 1024 when really you're actually only use 300 of them? This is super nitpicky because obviously this is making frame rate like 10 times over, but, and so I'm not like judging the developer's ability to do this, but if you have a game where you're missing 20%, let's say you want to ship on Go, it's a 60 FPS device and you're at like 52 and you don't know what to do. Go look at the size of your textures and figure out which ones you're using and which one you're not using. And the ones you're not using, get the resolution lower, and literally you will not notice the difference if you're not getting close to that texture, and then figure out if your users can or cannot get close. Cool. Last thing I want to show on Ocean Rift is that, as you can see, the draw call, every draw call, like for example this water draw call, is only emitted once. Why is that? Because they're using multi-view. That means that you do not need to execute the draw call for the left eye and the right eye. You will only send the draw call once, and then it will be duplicated on the left and the right eye automatically for you. It's one of the major optimizations we worked on. It can be a pain to get working, but the speedups you get from it on the CPU side are amazing. It's not although it does look like a GPU optimization, a lot of people get that wrong and think that it's gonna make your GPU faster. The GPU doesn't really care. It's gonna do the projection for the left eye and the right eye anyway. It's not gonna share the pixels because since you have a different camera, you could be looking at different things. But on the CPU side, it's huge. So here you see that we only have a texture array. So we don't have two textures, we have one texture and it's a texture array. So you have slice zero here and we can change it here in RenderDoc. Slice zero is the left eye and slice zero is the right eye. As I finish my texture, when you click between zero and one, you can see the difference in projection between the left and the right eye slightly. We'll see this better on future apps where we have more close stuff. Cool. And so this is gonna be the end of the Ocean Rift stuff. Last thing I wanted to call out is that something that's really cool about RenderDoc is that you get to store the traces that you did. So here, I just double-clicked on that trace and I was able to replay it on my PC, right? But if you do right-click, save, it's gonna create an RGC file that then you can send to your code developers that you can store, you can replay later without the app even needing to be on the device. One of the things that's really cool is that it stores everything. So it's a pretty big file. It stores everything you need in order to replay. So you do not actually need to replay it on a device that is the same with the device that you captured it from. It just needs to be a device that shares the same general OpenGL features. As I was developing this, the main developer of RenderDoc is a guy in the UK called Boulder Carlson. He does not have an Oculus Quest, he does not have an Oculus Go, And I was developing this with him, right, in order for this to work. And sometimes we had traces that crashed, especially with multi-view. And I sent him traces, and he replayed them on his Pixel XL, because that's the only Android device he had. And Pixel XL does not have VR API, does not have a runtime. He definitely doesn't have 6DoF tracking. But he was able to replay them because the Pixel XL runs OpenGL ES and has the multi-view extension. And that's all you really need. So you can share this with other devs to be able to share your work. So you say, hey, like, for example, I just had this trace. Like, do you have any idea of how to make this faster? Or do you want to help me make my game faster? Or hey, this is how I implemented a cool water system. Do you want to put this in your game? Collaboration, yay. So today we're going to do we're going to use this RDC trace opening feature in order to look at traces that I've captured before this talk in order for us to talk about it. So I'm going to do open capture here. So where did I put everything? And we're going to try to replay roller coaster, which sometimes crashes. So I'm actually going to close this first. Quit. Perfect. Roller coaster. Transferring. So the bigger your trace is, the longer it's going to take for it to replay on the device. So Ocean Rift was mainly really, really fast because Ocean Rift has like 6 draw calls. This is epic roller coasters, and it will take longer. It loaded. Amazing. This is what the game looks like. It's a game that we have on Go and on Gear VR. As you can see from the Gear VR remote here, I actually didn't even capture this on Oculus Quest. I captured it on Gear VR, which is why you see the Gear VR remote. But Gear VR and Oculus Quest both use GLES 3.1. Therefore, it can replay. Perfect. So I wanted to call out specific things about this app. Some things that they did good and some things that they could further optimize just for everybody's learning experiences. So the first thing that I did like a lot is this draw call. It might be simple, but actually a lot of people get that wrong. So this is the first draw call that they do, which is the sky map. Obviously, they are over water, so they can't get away with just clearing like the Ocean Rift guys did. So they actually render a sky map. The output looks like this. The input looks like this. This is a cube map, so you get to go through the different slices. And as you can see here in GL draw elements 36, 36 is the number of indices. This is what the mesh looks like. 36 is the minimum number of indices for a cube. And so they just rendered a cube around you and then mapped their cube map on the cube. It sounds simple, and it sounds like what you would do, but based on personal experience, that is not what people do. If you look at the default UE4 sky implementation, it is a sphere mapping around you that is around 5,000 or 6,000 vertices, and they use this to be able to do dynamic sky computation, so that you can have the sun going from left to right. It's all procedurally done, and you get to change the color of the sky because you can compute it in the vertices. This is why you have such an expensive mesh. If your game is mainly during daylight and is just moving a roller coaster around, you do not need to have a 5,000 poly mesh just to map your cube map around. Take your cube map, map it on a cube, put it around you, done in exactly 12 triangles. Just like think about things you can get away with when you're developing for mobile VR, because you need to get away with stuff. And here, they went with a simpler route, which is an amazing route. Which doesn't mean their sky looks bad, because they pre-computed everything into a beautiful cube map, and then they just have that cube map around you. Since it's just like 3-minute rides on roller coasters, they don't need dynamic light, or they definitely do not need like day and night schedule, so they got away with it. If I did want to be a bit of a stickler again, I will say that their sky map here is 2048 by 2048. So you might ask me, yeah, but the sky is important and it's pretty big around you. Did they need 2048 or did they need less? So now we're going to do a bit of math. Think about it. The default Oculus Go resolution is 1024 by 1024. Okay? It has 90-degree field of view, both vertical and horizontal. Guess what also has 90-degree... guess what is also using 90-degree field of views? A cube map. Because the cube map has 6 faces, each one of them mapping to 90-degree field of view. Since your output texture, the one you're rendering into, is only 1024 by 1024, you do not need a 2048-2048 input image in order to map that the same field of view into your 1024-1024 texture. You're oversampling by a factor of 4x. So just like think about those things. It's not, again, a huge issue because they have MIP maps. So if it was really big, the GPU would sample from the lower MIP map. But in this case, I'm pretty sure the GPU is sampling from the big one because they're just above the MIP map level below. And so that is a lot of bandwidth. And the result would be the same if they were using a, like maybe a 1,200 pixel QMAP by 1,200 pixel. They would lower their bandwidth by more than 2x and have the exact same output because you cannot store more than 1024 by 1024 pixels on a 1024 by 1024 texture because that's how stuff works. Cool. Now we get to step through. Let me go back to this main texture. And they have a fairly, I thought, good-looking game where you get to go through fairly complex scenes with your little roller coaster cart here all the way to the end. So they have foliage and everything. We can see that the depth buffer works on this one. So you can see exactly all the data that they're storing in the depth. And I did want to call out a couple stuff. So the first one I want to focus on is the rocks. So you see here, at first I have obviously nothing in my terrain, right? And then I'm starting to draw a rock. This is around 300 to 400 vertices. And then I draw more rocks, like those three in front. So you see here, I have just one rock, and then two, and three. So let's think about rocks for a minute. Rocks, since this is not a destructible game, are fairly static. They don't usually move very much. They're just like rocks. They also look a lot alike. Specifically, you can see that they share the same number of indices, but mainly, the main thing I want to focus on is that they're going to stay in the same place. They're also really close to each other. So it's very, very unlikely in this case that you're going to see one rock, but not see the other one. There is a big reason why you would want to have different draw calls for objects that are far from each other. And that's called frustum calling. When you have a very complex scene with objects everywhere, the CPU, before sending the draw call to the GPU, is going to do what we call frustum calling. It's going to look at the objects around you. It's going to figure out approximately where your camera is and where you're looking. And it's going to say, well, if you're looking north and you have an object 500 meters south, then obviously, or 1,500 feet for Americans, then obviously you do not need to render it because it's all the way behind you. That is added cost on the CPU because you need to execute all of this on the CPU. Now you have different objects. You need to do different draw calls. But you sometimes have a lot of GPU wins because you will not draw certain objects while you would in other times. But here, those rocks are really similar and right next to each other, and they will never move because they're static rocks. So here, if you're having performance problems, this is a great place where you could use what we call batching. So instead of having those rocks as separate draw calls and separate objects, you just use tools, like most engines will do that for you, or your editing tools like Blender or something will do that for you as well. You just merge them into like a big rock that would have all those three rocks together, and you just say that's only one object. If your rocks have different textures, this is when you use atlasing, where you say, I have a big square texture, and I'm going to store the textures from the left rock, and the bottom rock, and the right rock. This will make your games on the CPU side significantly faster, because you only have one draw call. And you will not save any cycles that you could have saved by seeing only one object and not the others because they're so close to each other. This happens again here when you look at all those little draw calls that look exactly similar to draw the trunk of the trees. You know that those draw calls are the same, even not even looking at this, just by looking at the number of indices there are in them. You see this GeoDraw elements here? It's 261. 261, 261, 261. That's too similar for it not to be the same mesh. If you go to mesh output here and you look at the input side, you can see that this is what the trunk looks like. It's a normal tree trunk. And they're always the exact same trunk. So what you could do here, for example, is you could use what we call instancing. Instancing is where you you say, I have this single draw call, this single object. I don't want to batch multiple objects together because I know they're actually going to be just multiples of the same tree trunk. And there's a GL command called gldrawInstance, which has been implemented over and over in all engines. Or you can say, draw, you GPU, draw this object five times with those five different positions. So still one draw call, but you get to draw your objects without duplicating them in multiple places. So if you're having performance problems using instancing and figuring out where you can use instancing by looking at the draw calls in RenderDoc is a great thing. One of the things I thought they did really amazingly well is that they were able to get a great low poly mesh for their cart without the gameplay experience looking bad. So if you look at the mesh output here, obviously this is kind of complicated, but at the same time when you think about it, this cart is going to be maybe like at least 40% of your field of view. You are literally sitting in it, you're going to look at it, you can see the handles, you can see everything, it's really close to you. So this is not the place where you want to be skimping on geometry detail. But they actually got it to only like 4,000 triangles, which is really impressive, because 4,000 triangles is not a lot. And you see, if you zoom in, for example, they managed to say that the floor would only be those couple, maybe those like 10 triangles around here. And they got this thanks to their fairly high resolution light map texture here. So they have a 2048 by 2048 texture, which is useful that it's 2048 because this is an atlas, so it's going to map to plenty of different places on their cart. And as you can see, the floor, they pre-baked all the lighting on the floor to be able to make you believe that you have a high-resolution floor with all that geometry without actually paying that cost at all in the vertex shader. They pre-computed all the reflections. You see, like, you can see the reflections in all the areas of the cart. And since they basically kept the sun and the orientation kind of at the same place, most people actually won't notice. And this is the type of stuff that you want to be doing here. You figure out what your game can get away with. You figure out what your users aren't going to notice because they're more focused on like the giant flying dragon coming at your cart rather than like, hey, I wonder if the reflection is like procedurally based or not. And you get away with that. So I thought they did a great job here. The last thing I wanted to call out, and this is actually really important, and if there's like only one part of this talk that you actually focus on, I would like it to be now, is that there is here a draw call, this little tiny one here in the back, that is not lining up with the others. If I close this color pass, I have a draw call at the end. So this is like getting my spidey senses tingling, right? Because I'm just wondering, like, what does that draw call need to do for it to be so fancy and not with the other draw calls and their little friends on the principal frame buffer, right? So another thing that could have gotten me wondering what was happening is that you get to see that for the main pass, the name of my frame buffer here, the FBO0, is called temp buffer 6. And I'm like, that's a weird name for a buffer because it's the one I'm going to be submitting to VR API for composition. And temp buffer definitely sounds like a temporary buffer, and that's not really what it is. So let's figure out what happens here. Let's click on this GL draw elements. So it's only 6 indices. So 6 indices either is not a lot of vertices, but it also sounds a lot like a cube or like a quad, I mean. And quads in graphics often map to the screen, and that's not very good. If we look at the mesh output here, input is just a quad, as I thought, and output is a really big quad that surprisingly matches exactly with my texture. That's a full screen quad, so it's not projected, it's just everywhere on my screen. If we look at Texture Viewer here, it's outputting into something called RT Device iTexture Array 2, which sounds like something significantly more professional than Denver for 6. So that's actually the thing that's going to be submitted to VR API. And my input is temp buffer 6. So it's actually getting temp buffer 6 and copying it into that other buffer. So it's doing a full frame copy, which is insanely expensive. So let's try to figure out why it did that. So first, did it do anything? Let's look at temp buffer 6 here. And so what temp buffer 6 looks like. I'm going to now double click into RT device iTexture array 2. It doesn't change anything. So it doesn't seem it's actually not doing anything useful. It's not like it's doing bloom. We can talk about, like, should you do bloom? You should not do bloom, but like at least it would be doing bloom, right? But this doesn't actually do anything. So they must have thought it was doing something, because otherwise it wouldn't be there. So let's try to figure that out. We're going to do that by looking at pipeline state. Pipeline state, obviously, fragment shader has as input my temp buffer 6 thing that we rendered into before. And then we're going to look at the shader. Shader, view, all right. This is a fairly simple shader, and we're going to look at the bottom portion of it. So here, the main thing I see is UXT lats equals texture main text. Main text is the uniform sampler for the Timber for 6. So it's just sampling from the main texture as we expected it because it's doing a full screen copy. And then it's multiplying it by underscore color, which as we can see here up top is a uniform vector. So that means that basically it's doing a full screen copy and then multiplying it by a color. So since it didn't do anything, like obviously you guys should all know what this color thing contains, which since it's not doing anything is 1, 1, 1, 1, because multiplied by 1, not much happens. If you go to resource inspector, if you go to pipeline state in fragment shader, in uniforms here, I can see one variable, which is my color. If I click on go, I can see what actually got sent to the GPU here, which is really useful if you're wanting to debug the uniforms that you sent. And as I said, it was 1, 1, 1, 1. So what they were trying to do, and which is something that I have seen a lot, so please do not believe, oh, well, they've just made a mistake, like everybody makes it. So at this point, it's really not a mistake, and it's not just something that a lot of people just do, is that use this to do fade to black. They just wanted, and that makes perfect sense, they wanted to have like a black system, so that would be your rendering, but you multiply by 0, and then you slowly fade in your texture until 1, and then you just kept it when the game was actually rendering. So for your info, this little multiplication and full screen copy takes 2.5 milliseconds on this device, because those are multiple million pixels, and just getting, like, since they're in different frame buffers, when the first frame buffer executes, it will then, tile by tile, store all of the outputs of that frame buffer into the general memory, because you can't save all that data in GPU, because the GPU doesn't have enough memory to store it. And since it's so many pixels, you're saving that out all the way to what we call GMEM, which is general memory, and then you do your other pass, which is just really copying that, but then, what you need to do is you need to get all that data all the way from GMEM back tile by tile to the GPU memory. You multiply it by 1 and then you store it all the way back again. There's a reason why we tell everyone to not do post-process. When you do post-process, although the operations that you do is just multiply by 1, which your GPU, although it's not a 2080 Ti, again, like it does multiply by 1 perfectly fine. What bounds GPUs like these is not operations. They actually do operations fairly fast. What bounds them is bandwidth. And here you are consuming a lot of bandwidth. So let's think about different ways to do a fade to black system with zero bandwidth costs. The easiest way is you draw a full screen quad again in your main pass just in front of your camera. You make it completely black, transparent, and you modify the transparency. If you do that, it's going to be in the last draw call that you actually send, so you put the priority all the way to low so that you know it's going to be the last draw call that actually gets sent. And since it's using normal OpenGL blending, it is executing its operations, which is multiplying what you just rendered, which is in the destination buffer, but what you're sending it, which is a zero color multiplied by your transparency opacity coefficient, but it's doing that in the same frame buffer execution. So that's one way to do it, which is what most people are doing. But also the other way, and that's what we're working on right now, is that since you're going to be sampling, the compositor is going to be sampling from that texture during distortion time. So what we did is that we added on the compositor side a value called color scale, where when the compositor is going to be sampling from your texture, it's actually going to multiply it in the compositor by a certain value. And we're going to, in the engine integrations, just expose that value so that you cannot modify anything. And then in the Unreal 4 blueprints, for example, you will have a set color scale thing that you can just say, I want color scale 0.5. And then the compositor, when it receives your eye texture, will multiply it by 0.5 without necessitating any additional frame buffer copies. So that is it for roller coasters. I blew over my time. All right, let's continue. So I wanted to show very quickly a quill capture. So let's go on quill. Transferring. One of the reasons I like it is because it's beautiful. So if you look at this, this is one of our quill meshes. Why did I click on mesh output? I want texture viewer. Thank you. So this is a quill render of very obviously the Golden Gate in the beautiful SF Bay Area on sunrise, because the sun is in the west. As in every OpenGL, as in every RenderDoc trace, you can step through it and you can see that it's actually made of plenty of different submeshes. They are just adding on top of the experience in order to create that scene. One of the things that's fairly interesting, if you have good eyes and you can see this from all the way in the back, is that those GLDraw elements instanced are huge in terms of triangles. This scene has around 500,000 triangles. Unlike a normal scene on Go or Oculus Quest, where you want to stay in like the 100,000 range, you want to stay in that 100,000 range because you have very expensive pixel shaders with lighting and stuff like that. Cool doesn't have any of this. The pixel shader is two lines and it's vertex colors, but you have a lot of vertices. And so I was working with the Cool team in order to try to figure out how we're going to get Cool rendering faster. And so we're using actually RenderDoc in order to figure out where the vertices were going and which ones we needed to use and not use. And I just wanted to focus specifically on the, let me find this draw call here. So you see, let me find it. Ah, sorry. All right, so between this texture here, this this partial playback stage here, and this partial playback stage here, the only thing that changes really is those little shapes at the bottom of the Golden Gate's legs. So it's obviously very important, the artist put it there for a reason, but it's not a huge change. However, if you look at the number of indices, that's 132,000 indices. So that's around 40,000 triangles, so that's a lot of triangles. But if we're just looking at the texture, which is the post-projection things that actually got changed, it doesn't look like much. So let's look at what those triangles are actually doing. The cool thing with mesh output in, the cool thing with mesh output out is that you see here in, you don't really know what is ending up in your texture by just looking at this mesh. Obviously the mesh looks big, there are lines here, and it really should probably be split, but you're not that sure what is important to split and what is not. However, if you look at vertex out here, you will get to see exactly what ends up in your texture from the point of view of the camera, which is something that you don't usually get to see because either you're looking at your mesh before projection, so you see the mesh, or you're looking at it post-projection, but only the stuff that actually changed the texture. Here you get to look at both because I can look around and look at the mesh. So here you can see both platforms under the feet that are in the middle here, here and here. But also, interestingly enough, on the right side, I have this huge ferry, which, although it's very important because if you want to go to Sausalito, you don't want to take the Golden Gate Bridge, probably doesn't need to be rendered here because it's outside of my texture. And on the left side, I have Fort Point, if I recall correctly, which is also beautiful, but really doesn't need to be rendered here either. So this is where we started seeing that the current way of storing the Quill FBX scenes we were doing too few draw calls with too many things batched, and so we weren't able to use frustum calling to say, I only want the 2 feet here, but I do not want the ferry. Because the ferry here, it would have been fairly easy for the CPU to just say, your field of view is 90 degrees, the ferry is obviously 130 on your right, we're not drawing it. Here it needed to draw the ferry because it was in the same mesh as those 2 steps. So I just want to call out here that VS out is really important in order to figure out where your vertices are going. And I also wanted to show it because I think the scene is like beautiful. It really is, because San Francisco is so beautiful. Anyway, cool. Let's continue and go look at Bogo. Bogo Cool, I think it is. Bogo Cool. So Bogo Cool, Bogo really. Bogo is one of our test applications that we developed for Oculus Connect 4. And you basically just get to be in a scene that kind of looks like a fairy tale, kind of, on a platform with a little monster, and you get to interact with the monster by throwing apples at it and like cooking for it and stuff like that. Whenever you want RenderDoc. So now RenderDoc is, it's actually going. The bigger your app is, the longer it's going to take for RenderDoc to successfully load it, because it actually cannot play it on the computer. The reason for that is because the computer doesn't actually run OpenGL, yes. The computer runs OpenGL, but doesn't have extensions such as MultiView. And it would also not have the same, let's say, like, It's important that the device runs it because you would, since you have different implementations of this of OpenGL, even if it was running the same API such as Vulkan, for example, the driver bugs would be different. And it is really important to replay on the device so that you can actually see on your computer the thing that matters to you, which is how it works on the device. And basically, last thing before we go to Q&A is I wanted to talk about their hidden object rendering, because that is something that I have seen a lot matter and not be considered enough. So this is a fairly complex app to render. So let's quickly look at this. So this is the main texture for Bogo. It's rendering a 1216 by 1216. And again, it's using multi-view. Everybody really on those devices is using multi-view because it makes the development, like, it makes the render thread so much faster. And I wanted to focus on something here that basically all the draw calls that you're submitting should really be affecting your color texture. Otherwise, there's a fair point, like there's a case to be made that that draw call really shouldn't be there. So here, for example, as I click on the second part, on the next draw call here, as you can see, it's modifying the underneath of this little cooking pan to put the bottom lid. You could make the case to say, well, they're next to each other. Shouldn't they be bashed, as you said? No, because they're dynamic objects. Further in the game, you can actually take the top off to be able to cook. So that's why they're two separate objects. So this is all good. And then when I click on this draw call, whenever it actually computes, I can see that absolutely nothing changes. Well, that's pretty weird. Like, wouldn't you want draw calls to actually matter? Let's look at what that draw call does. So let's look at inputs for a minute. So inputs, I can see the texture is final statue. So it's a 1024 by 1024 texture, which obviously looks like a light atlas. It's called a statue, so there's probably a statue somewhere. This is just a tone mapping, a really small tone mapping texture. If we go to mesh output, we can see that in VS in, this is what the statue looks like. So it looks like a statue to me. But in the texture viewer, I don't see any statue. So there's a significant case to be made that maybe the statue is right off your field of view on the right side and just isn't seen. But the frustum calling just conservatively put it in, and there's really nothing that you could do in this case, right? But interestingly enough, it's not the case. If you look at mesh output, VS out, it's being rendered because it's in the field of view. You can see all those vertices post-projection that are definitely making it on the texture. But texture viewer, they're not there because there's the floor here. So let's figure out if this got rendered on top of the floor or under the floor. How you do this is in mesh output, again, you can fly around, you can ask RenderDoc to put on top all the vertices that got rendered in previous draw calls by going from this draw here to whole pass. So this is going to take a while because it needs to render all the vertices from the other passes and put them on top. But whenever that's done, you can actually fly around basically your scene post projection. So you get to see the little cooking thing that we had, the floor, and you get to see that this statue is under the floor. So this is why we're not seeing it, because it's under the floor. The floor is there. So I actually talked to the dev team about this, and when you play the game, you actually know that further along in the game experience, when you feed the creature, then those statues come out of the floor and you get to pick the statue and interact with them. And so they need to come from below the floor, but for the majority of the experience, that statue is below the floor. You know it's below the floor. Since there's floor everywhere, it's never gonna be seen, but they put it there and forgot to hide it. When you hide an object, and when I mean hide, I don't mean hide by putting it below the floor. I mean putting the little checkbox or setting in C++ or in Unity, putting the actual like hidden flag on it. It's gonna, on the render thread of your game, the first thing that most render threads do is they look at if your object is hidden. If it's hidden, you do not need to compute its projection matrix. You do not need to take it into account in frustum calling. You do not need to go bind all the textures for it. You just don't do anything about it. And on the GPU side, obviously, you also do not need to project anything because you didn't, well, render. So just think, like, this is the type of stuff that you can see with a frame debugger that would show you, well, this object I know is actually never gonna make it in the scene for the next 2 minutes. Let me save my GPU and CPU a bunch of time and like remove it from rendering whatsoever. So this is pretty much it. And the last thing I wanna show is a bug of mine, because that's fairly important, is that it kind of looks like Lucy in the Sky and Diamonds right now, but we have a bug on Unreal 4.20. So remote server disconnected. Awesome. Well, it was the end of the presentation anyway. Cool. The last thing I wanted to say, and this is actually a great time to go do that because it just crashed, is that this is a work in progress. And we have two devs on this. It's me and Boulder Colton that runs, that actually is the main developer of the tool. It is going to crash. When it does, if it crashes a lot for you, please grab the Android Logcats. If you got any trace, grab it as well, and send a bug report to me, and I will honestly try to go fix it. The other part is that when it crashes, and if I fix a bug, it's gonna end up in nightlies. So if it doesn't work for you, grabbing nightlies is likely to be a significantly better experience, although nightly sometimes the top of tree is a bit unstable because it's top of tree. Email me and ask me, hey, like I have this bug, did you fix it? I fixed the 4.20 bug recently. I'm aware of bugs that of future runtimes that I will need to fix, and I will continue working on this, so let me know. The last thing is that when you do GPU profiling, something that takes an insane amount of memory. And we have a lot of issues right now with applications that already are hitting the memory limit on the of the device. If on top of that, you are also doing GPU profiling, you're gonna go basically over the memory limit, and then the OS starts playing Russian roulette and kill random processes, which is always very fun. So what you actually wanna do in here is you wanna, unless you're doing a replay, RenderDoc actually does not take a lot of memory. So what you wanna be doing is you wanna capture your app, do a bunch of captures like I showed before, and then instead of replaying them by double clicking on them, you just right click and save. That will grab you your RGC trace that is standalone again. Just grab the ones you're interested in, save them on disk, and then shut off your app. Now, your app doesn't need to be there. It's just cleared this whole memory. Then open RenderDoc and replay your traces. It's a bit less efficient, obviously, and we apologize for that. But at the end of the day, that will help you, and that is the main way. If you have an app that is consuming a lot of memory, you load, capture all the traces, save them on your computer, kill your app, replay. We have exactly 3 minutes for Q&A. Thank you for listening.